Hi again, and welcome to the third video in this series around the classic Mac Pro 1.1. In this video, I'll be upgrading the dual Intel Xeon CPUs in this machine and see how that improves performance in both macOS X and Windows 11. As this is the third video in the series, I do recommend that you have a look at the first two episodes in case you haven't done that yet. In those two videos, I gave an overview of this Apple Mac Pro 1.1, both from hardware and software side, and I explain how to install the latest possible macOS X version and Windows 11 on it, and why that would be a good idea. As we've seen as well in those previous videos, this Mac Pro, despite being over 15 years old now, is still usable for standard desktop usage like web browsing, watching videos, or doing administrative work. After all, at release, this was a real beast of a machine. My model is the middle spec version, and it came with two Intel Xeon 5150 CPUs, clocked at 2.66 GHz with two cores each. This is how that looks like in about this Mac and on Windows. To measure the performance of the original configuration, I will run the Geekbench CPU test before we do the CPU upgrade. On macOS X, I'm not able to use Geekbench 5 or the newest Geekbench 6, as it is no longer compatible with OS X El Capitan installed here. So I ran Geekbench 4. I first had to go through a workaround related to the root SSL certificate that was no longer being seen as valid, but eventually we got the result of the benchmark. 5049 for multicore. In Windows 11, we can run the latest version of Geekbench, and as Geekbench 6 is still pretty new, I decided to test with both version 5 and 6. In version 5, we get the following as a result. 1250 is not that great, but again, don't forget that this machine is 15 years old. To put this in perspective, around the same time of the Mac Pro 1.1 launch, the Intel Core 2 Duo was released on the market. The top model there gets around half that score with the same test. Now for Geekbench 6, which seems to take a lot longer to test, we can see the following result. Now that we've captured how the original two Xeon 5150s are performing, let's have a look at what options we have for the CPU upgrade. This is a table with all supported CPUs on the Mac Pro 1.1 hardware. As you can see, the bottom part has the three original Mac Pro 1.1 configurations, and our machine has two Woodcrest 5150s with two cores running at 2.66 GHz. We could upgrade to the 5160, but more interesting is to upgrade to the Cloverton architecture, as this doubles the amount of cores. In the right column, you can see that this would require a firmware flash to the Mac Pro 2.1 firmware. My machine was already flashed as covered in the earlier videos, so I won't go into too much detail about that. I'll put a card here and a link in the description to another YouTuber's video that covers this process in detail. Looking at what was available for a reasonable price, I decided to go for two X5355s for the upgrade. I found that a pair of these on eBay goes for around $15. X5365 seems to go for about the double, and although it's still not very expensive, it doesn't justify the difference in performance. Enough about the theory, let's get these CPUs upgraded. As a start, I will remove all drive bays from the machine. This is not strictly necessary, but gives you some more room in the case to work. Next, we need to get the video card out. Followed by the two cards that host the memory. Okay, this was the easy part. Now we need to remove the cage on the right side that holds the memory cards and also the plastic fan assembly on the left. To start, we need to remove the two screws that fix the right cage on the motherboard side. And two screws that fixes it to the bottom of the case. Sliding this part slightly to the right allows us to remove the cover for the CPU heatsinks and gives us a first glimpse on the two CPU coolers. For the left part, there is a screw on the motherboard that holds this in place, which we need to get out first. Then we can wiggle the plastic part out. It's held in place on the left top side to the front of the case and in some kind of a sliding mechanism on the bottom. What I find to be working the easiest was to gently pull it forward, bottom left, and then to do the same on the right side. No need to disconnect any connectors here, as this nicely connects to a header directly on the motherboard. You might also have noticed that everything is pretty clean here and there is hardly any dust to see. But that's because I prepared this beforehand. I did the reassembly without removing the heatsinks earlier to test how this goes, and while doing so, I took the opportunity to remove a lot of accumulated dust. The next part which we have to remove is the cage that holds those memory cards. To get this one out, we need to move the plastic rear fan duct backwards first. Unfortunately, this also requires a bit of forcing. The plastic part is held with some clips, and by slightly bending the cage, we can release these. The front part is pretty easy, but it can be a pain to do this in the back close to the motherboard. Just take your time here and be gentle. Once the fan is moved backwards enough, you should get enough room to get the cage out. Here, the fan does have a connector to the motherboard, which you first need to disconnect. Now that this is also removed, it gives us a nice look at the impressive motherboard of this machine. Alright, almost at our CPUs. The last step is to remove the heatsinks, which are held in place with 4 3mm hex key screws on each heatsink. A longer tool would come in handy here, but short does the job as well, and I guess that's what she said. Eventually, after loosening all the screws and disconnecting the temperature sensor, we can remove the heatsinks and get to see the originally installed CPUs covered in thermal paste. And just I don't know about you, but I can just keep staring at this motherboard for hours, which is, to my ID, an amazing piece of engineering, and I keep discovering new and cool things on it. But back to our CPU upgrade. Let's clean up the old thermal paste on both CPU and heatsink side. And then it is finally time to get those old CPUs out of their socket. We can get a closer look at them for the last time, because this pair of X5355s will replace the 5150s. Same frequency, but double the amount of cores and twice as much cache. All we need to do for that is to drop them in the socket in the right orientation and close it. After some fresh thermal paste, the reassembly starts, which is basically the reverse process that we did to get to the CPUs. So I'm starting by putting back the heatsinks and fixing them back to the motherboard. Once that is done, we can connect back the temperature sensors. And put back the plastic fan duct that goes left from the CPUs. It's just a matter of carefully sliding it in place. That goes a lot easier than the trouble we had getting it out. Once it is back, we can also fix it again to the motherboard. Next up is the cage that holds the memory cards. Here, we first need to connect the back fan to the motherboard. Since I find it easier to get that fan back in place when the cage is fixed, I'll first put back the CPU heatsink cover, as it will be difficult to do so afterwards. So, after fixing that cage, we need to push back the fan and plastic around it back in place. Again, this takes a bit of wiggling and forcing. Just as before, take it calm and gentle, and eventually things should click back in place. To make sure we're good here, we can insert the cards holding the memory. Looks like this goes without any issues, so the reassembly is as good as done. All that's left is to put back the GPU, and the drive cages. I did notice here on the video that the cover for the CPU heatsinks was not 100% back in place, but a gentle push on top fixed that later. Now the moment of truth. Always a bit nervous to see how this goes, especially if you know that in case something didn't go well here, we will need to disassemble everything again. And with that NVIDIA GT120, we don't get to see a boot screen, so it takes a bit longer before we can see if this even worked. Alright, this is a good sign. We managed to get to the login prompt, so at least one of the CPUs must be working. Now let's have a look at about this Mac. Two 2.66GHz quad-core CPUs, exactly what we want to see. Geekbench confirms as well that this machine now has two Xeon X5355s. Nice to see. Let's test performance right away here. ...8,339 is the result. With the original CPUs, we managed to get 5,049, so this is definitely a proper improvement. Around 60% better is not bad at all. Let's boot to Windows 11 now. As expected, we see the same in about on Windows as in OS X. Two X5355 Xeon CPUs. Task Manager also looks a bit more impressive with double the amount of cores here. So, as I did on macOS X, let me rerun the Geekbench benchmarks as I did before the upgrade. Starting with Geekbench 5. ...2090 is what we get here, compared to 1250 earlier. Again, the result is around 60% higher. Let's repeat the same with Geekbench 6 now. ...1355 with the upgraded CPU versus 896 originally. Here's an overview of these benchmark results. I guess for only $15, this is a bit of a no-brainer. What I also did in the previous videos was a test by looking at the CPU consumption during 1080p YouTube video playback. I captured the same after the upgrade, and we can clearly see the difference here again. The CPU is noticeably less stressed after the upgrade, and there is a lot more room for multitasking, showing once more the performance gain we achieved. Still, even though this cheap CPU upgrade makes the machine noticeably faster, we have to face reality, and if we compare the performance with some other machines I tested recently, we have to admit that the best days for the Mac Pro 1.1 are probably over. I mean, it still performs well enough for a lot of tasks, but a big factor which you can't ignore here is power consumption. Those two Xeons with a TDP of 120 watt each, together with the rest of the hardware, will cost you a better performing alternative machine with the same or better performance, only with the electricity bill. Nevertheless, I don't know about you, but I had a lot of fun playing around with this Mac Pro 1.1 despite it being unwanted. Thanks a lot for watching, I hope you have enjoyed this video series. Let me know in the comments if you have used or still are using a similar machine, and as always, a thumbs up would be nice, and don't forget to subscribe if you like this kind of videos. Thanks again, and hope to see you back here soon.